Hey, is it working? Oh, there we go. We're good. Yo. What's good, everyone? This is Goodz Reads. The author is John Findlater. The book is The Revolutionary Movement, A Diagnosis of World Disorders. The year is 1933, and this is part two, April 5th, 2021. And we still reading the book. Probably never thought it would ever happen. This generation is divided equally between the most asleep and the most awake. The remnant lives on. All right. Let's continue where we left off, right when it was getting good. So we're on page 4. Hold on, this thing opened by accident. Oh my gosh. Close this. Thank you. All right, here we go. So it says, is this where we were? This is where we were, right? Whatever, this, I don't know. I'm pretty sure this is where we were. No, it's right here. Wait, no, this is the same thing. Okay, so it says, the seeds of that French Revolution were sown broadcast by Voltaire, whose character has been thus summed up by Sir Archibald Alison. Quote, he was all things to all men. With equal readiness, he dealt out generosity for the generous, bravery for the brave, wisdom for the wise, selfishness for the selfish, voluptuousness for the voluptuous, profligacy for the profligate, end quote. History of Europe, Volume 1, 81 and 9th. Because he's a Jesuit, they love to corrupt what Paul said, be all things to all men, which is the complete opposite of what the Jesuits are. The Jesuits are shapeshifters. They'll be anything you want them to be, whereas the follower of Yahusha will be anything you need them to be, not what you want them to be. So it has nothing to do with the flesh. Jesuits cater to your flesh. Yashar’el caters to the spirit. So, no, Paul's not a, what do you call it? What did they say? False prophet. It's like, all right, whatever. So it says, now look at this other picture. Reluctantly drawn by the hand of Scotland's most distinguished foreign missionary, and note that family features. Quote, among the learned Jesuits showed themselves lovers of learning. Among the illiterate, they upheld the maxim. Ignorance is the mother of devotion. Among the free, they were advocates of liberty. Among the bond, apologists for slavery. Among the upright, they feigned integrity. Among the unscrupulous, they encouraged fraud. Among atheists, deists, or Jews, they could repudiate the God of the Bible and the Savior of men. Among Protestants, they could appear with an ultra zeal for Protestantism. Among pagan idolaters, they could sanction the most degrading idolatry and superstition. Among self-tormenting ascetics, they could submit to the most grievous self-inflicted severities. End quote. Dr. Alexander Duff, The Jesuits, page 41. And I have many similar quotes about that. Similar thing, like, I'll be anything to anyone just to get in. All right, this is what they were created for. So it says, both Allison and Duff produced detailed evidence for each of the charges made, which for anyone conversant with the facts of Voltaire's career and with the history of the Company of Jesus, it would not be difficult to multiply. Like Voltaire, Napoleon had been trained in the schools of the Jesuits. Allison's summary of his character occupies nearly 2 pages of his history, volume, 12? Volume 12, 273 to 4. Some of the most outstanding features are that Napoleon was pervaded with ambition and covetousness of glory, careless of his pledged word, faithful to alliances only for so long as they were advantageous to himself, regardless of treaties when the keeping of them had become inexpedient, a thorough believer in the maxim that the end justifies the means, the Jesuit maxim. A ruler utterly reckless of human slaughter, a leader who lured on his followers by a thirst for glory and a hope of gathering great spoils. A saying of Napoleon's quoted by someone else is to this effect: man must have a religion. Were I in China, I should be a follower of Confucius. In Egypt, I was a Mohammedan. For the selfsame reason, here, I am Catholic. For almost as long as Voltaire had been the stormy petrel of European politics in the middle of the 18th century, at the end of that and the beginning of the 19th century, Napoleon was the raging leopard of European statescraft. On the wings of the mind, the former flew over the face of the stormy waters. With ravening claws, the latter spread death and desolation over the face of the earth. The two poles of the New World Order projected. The former became the vendor of its ideas. The latter traded in its brass tracks, or tacks. If in the net result Napoleon failed to achieve complete and enduring success, his failure was mainly due to the fact that the world at large had not, like the French, stocked its counters with the wares of Voltaire. More than a century's further work by the successors of Voltaire was needed ere the foundations could be laid for an integration of facts in that wider sphere where the new world order has lately been arising in so many fresh areas. If the Russian Revolution has proved itself but a repetition, on rather a larger scale, of the French, its ever outstanding feature proclaims but too surely its proper lineage. If Italian fascism is another product from the same factory, it may well be that in Italy, the Jesuits have succeeded in a way they liked better, but by a comparatively bloodless revolution. Temperamentally, the British are very different from... before we actually go on. Let's just read something else. From my website about Napoleon. Okay? Because I don't know if he talks about Napoleon later on. He probably does, but... just before we move on. So, if people don't know, they're new to this channel or anything what we're talking about, Napoleon, I can't even spell. Napoleon. Okay, so Napoleon Bonaparte. Okay, this is what I have. Italian Corsican tyrant, emperor of the French, France, 33rd degree Illuminized Freemason, knight of the Jesuit-controlled Roman Catholic Military Order of the Golden Fleece, knight of the Jesuit-created Order of the Seraphim, Roman Jesuit Grail Knight, and raised, educated, implemented, advised, controlled, and assassinated by the Jesuit Order for insubordination. In his memoirs, he says, quote, "The Jesuits are a military organization, not a religious order. Their chief is a general of an army, not the mere abbot of a monastery. And the aim of this organization is power. Power in its most despotic exercise, absolute power, universal power, pandemic power. Power to control the world by the volition of a single man. Jesuitism is the most absolute of despotisms. And at the same time, the greatest and most enormous of abuses." And this is the guy who created one of the most... He is known in history, whether people praise him or not. He's known as one of the most despotic rulers ever. And He says, Jesuitism is the most absolute of despotisms. "The general of the Jesuits insists on being master sovereign over the sovereign. Wherever the Jesuits are admitted, they will be masters, cost what it may. Their society is by nature dictatorial, and therefore it is the irreconcilable enemy of all constituted authority. Every act, every crime, however atrocious, is a meritorious work if committed for the interest of the society of the Jesuits or by the order of the general." Okay. So that's what Napoleon said in his memoirs. Remember, it was what was it? On July 15th, 1801, Napoleon Bonaparte there's a famous allegorical painting of the Concordat for reunification of the spiritual power / key of the Roman Catholic Church that was destroyed during the Protestant Reformation. It was established. And the new Holy Roman Empire of France to be given over to the United States of America, restored and signed between Jesuit crusader Napoleon Bonaparte and Jesuit superior general Franciscus Carew, standing behind the Jesuit rebuilder white Pope Pius VII and the College of Cardinals on July 15th, 1801. So that was what Napoleon's wars were for, to usurp the Reformation, or to usurp the, what was it called? French Revolution that the Jesuits started. It was all a big giant ruse. All right, so continuing, it says, if the Russian Revolution has proved itself but a repetition on rather a larger scale of the French, its ever outstanding feature proclaims but too surely its proper lineage. If Italian fascism is another product from the same factory, it may well be that in Italy the Jesuits have succeeded in a way they liked better, but a comparatively bloodless revolution. Temperamentally, the British are very different from both the French and the Russians, so that even if the general strike of 1926, the fascists and the communists had succeeded in creating the general and bloody turmoil they were working for, at worst, there would have been something far short of a French or a Russian revolution. But in other directions, there seemed to be dangers for us almost as great. To mention one only, for years past in our university center, some teachers have been steadily impressing on susceptible youth at those seats of learning that the British Constitution and our system of representative government have become thoroughly effete. So this is what they're saying in Canada. This is what they're saying in every country. The Constitution is void. It was never real to begin with. We need to destroy the government. The government's destroyed. If you don't understand what's going on in the world right now, you don't read your Bible. This is all the judgment. If you can't accept the judgment, you're not going to be saved. If you can't accept the judgment, Yahusha's not coming back for you. You got to understand we deserve everything that's going on right now. We're an evil, wicked generation. We got to repent. The Jesuits are our judgment. All right, so it says, Romans 13, right? So good things happen to good people, bad things happen to bad people. So, you know, whatever your ruler of your country does to you, you deserve it. That's it. Iniquity. So it says, and that the clement need of our time and the real hope for the future demand the setting up of a dictator a la Mussolini, whose confessor was Pietro Tacci Venturi, Jesuit priest, secretary of the Jesuit Superior General, Vladimir Ledikowski, who reestablished the temporal power of the papacy from the Second 30 Years' War, 1914 to 45, with the elite of our people holding every executive post under that dictator. The character of such a regime could the conspirators succeed in setting it up among us may be forecast with tolerable accuracy from such facts as these, that those most eager for dictatorship are as antagonistic to Bible religion as were Voltaire and Napoleon, that in public they pay such lip service to the church as those were wont to render, while privately they stab her in the back as did they, and that in nearly every Christian congregation there exists an abundance of dry tinder and great heaps of gunpowder ready for the falling sparks when some conflagration gets lighted up, and that is but one of the dangers to be reckoned with at the sudden bursting of the coming tornado. The French Revolution. No epoch of secular history has received so much attention as the French Revolution. And it's the greatest misconception of the French Revolution is the fact that it's called the French Revolution, because it's not the French Revolution. It should really be called the Western Revolution, the Western Revolution, the Revolution of the West, of the Western Mind. That's what it really should be called. The reestablishment of the spiritual power of the papacy, destroyed by the Reformation. No epoch of secular history has received so much attention as the Western Revolution. One recent writer has said that the bare titles of the books published upon it would fill a quarto volume of many hundred pages. For this contained interest, many reasons will readily occur to most minds, but perhaps the weightiest of all is that most histories of the period so obviously fail to tell what most needs to be known of it. The sketches they give are as pictures of faces with no noses and no eyes. What people must want to know is who in fact caused the French Revolution. Yet not all historians are thus strangely silent on this, the most important of all matters relating to that tragedy. Lord Acton, for instance, touches it explicitly. The appalling thing in the French Revolution is not the tumult, but the design. Through all the fire and smoke, we perceive the evidence of calculating organization. The managers remain studiously concealed and masked. There you go. But there is no doubt about their presence from the first. They had been active in the riots of Paris, and they were again active in the provincial rising. Lectures on the French Revolution, page 97. And now we're going through a worldwide revolution. The great Acta Latimore of the Jesuits. The seventh gate. All right, so... Yeah, and then it says, and Justin McCarthy has devoted five chapters of his history of the epoch to a review of the underground forces working for revolution. In the opening chapter, he quotes that lengthy passage of La Harpe's on which doubtless Dumas founded his weird prologue to, quote, the Queen's Necklace, end quote. McCarthy calls it, quote, that wonderful posthumous piece of fiction which La Harpe wrote under the guise of fact, end quote, adding, quote, 10 places it at the end of a study of the old order. It might more appropriately begin a record of the French Revolution, end quote. The scene depicted by La Harpe as having taken place in his presence differs in minor details only from the sketch given by Dumas in the prologue aforementioned. In his second chapter, McCarthy tells us a little concerning the origin and the operations of those underground forces afterwards, so prominent in the French Revolution, quote, the mysterious Illuminati with their strange cipher LPD, which being interpreted means Lilia Pedibus Destru and signifies the doom of kings. That strangest of Illuminati too, Balsamo Cagliostro. Yes, Giuseppe Balsamo was a Jesuit priest. I have many citations of him being a Jesuit priest. The Duke of, what was it? Friedrichburg or something like that in Prussia accused him of being a Jesuit. He was seen in full Jesuit garb in Rome. He was a Knight of Malta, at least. This is a public fact, but he was a Jesuit priest as well. And he influenced, and he created Egyptian Freemasonry, and he influenced, he was the first person to publish the Vatican manuscript of the Kabbalah. In fact, all the I won't get into it. It's a whole another story. Whatever. And all that was to come through him. We shall meet with Cagliostro in his season. And with the Illuminati and their terrible LPD, end quote. And of course he was a member of the Illuminati. Bavarian Illuminati. There was also the Avignon Illuminati 100 years before. Also made up by Roman Catholics. But you don't hear about that. Here at any rate is Hamlet staged with the ghost plainly in evidence at the forefront. Those Illuminati, McCarthy traces to an order of Freemasonry founded on the continent by certain Jacobite refugees in 1725. Yes, the Jacobites were Roman Catholics, okay? The Jacobite order of Freemasonry is the chapter of Clermont, created by the Jesuits, first 22 to 28. Created by the Jesuits. The College of Clermont, 1720 to 40, right? And then the finishing 33 from 73 to 90. And then the first three were 1590 to 1614. And that was by, I forget. It's on my website. The first three degrees were also created by a Jesuit. By you can read it in David Stevenson's History of Freemasonry. on my website. All right, so it says, if at first not very unlike British Freemasonry, so he's talking about Scottish Freemasonry and then there's Scottish Rite Freemasonry. Scottish Freemasonry was the first 3 degrees created by a Jesuit in 1590 to 1614. And then there's Scottish Rite Freemasonry, which was created in France in the 1720s to 40s. If at first not very unlike British Freemasonry, about the middle of the 18th century, it so changed its character under the molding hands of Adam Weishaupt, Spartacus, Fourth Vow ordained Jesuit priest. His parents died when he was a child. Okay. He was raised by the Jesuits at the Jesuit College of Ingolstadt. Okay. And he became a professor of Roman Catholic canon law at that Jesuit university, a position that is only held by a Jesuit. But all the Freemasonic historians will say, oh, yeah, he stopped being a Jesuit, though. And then he went on to create an order that used the constitutions of the Jesuit order to destroy the Jesuit order. But then the Jesuit order suppressed the Illuminati. This is a fact of history. You can read it on my website. It was the Jesuits who suppressed the Illuminati. And then the Jesuits get resurrected in 1814 or 18. It's like, okay. And of course, the Order of Perfection Nobilis. That was the original name of the Illuminati, the Order of the Perfection Nobilis. And since 1540, the company of the Jesuits has been known also as the Company of the Perfect. And of course, the Illuminati comes back from the Spanish Alumbrados, the pregenerators, the Spanish pregenerators of the Jesuits. Okay, so, oh my gosh. If at first, not very unlike Freemasonry, and then it says, Professor Robinson's evidence given in Appendix B shows that Continental Freemason had undergone a great change before Weishaupt and Cagliostro appeared, who changed it still further in the same direction. Yes, he's talking about proofs of a conspiracy by John Robinson, except what people don't talk about is that book is filled with a bunch of lies as well. I would say that book is smoke and mirrors, blown cover as cover. If you ever read that book and you actually know real history of the Jesuits, you'll know that it's like half true, half lies. So I think he actually contributed. Plus, he was a member of the Royal Society right when it was first started. So, which means he would have been an Order of the Golden Rosicrucians. Not the original Rosicrucians started by the Jesuits, but the Order of the Golden Rosicrucians, which were also started by the Jesuits. And I have this all linked in my website. You can just type it in, Golden Rosicrucians, all that stuff. Okay, so anyways. So it says, where is it? Yeah. About the middle of the 18th century, it was so changed in character under the molding hands of Adam Weishaupt and Count Cagliostro, two Jesuits. His real name was Giuseppe Balsamo. That is, that its first founders would not have known it. Okay, so we got it. Two Jesuit priests and a Jesuit Knight of Malta as well. Readers of the De Artagnan series of Dumas's romances may recall his sketches of a similar society under the control of the Jesuits in the days of Louis XIV, the Sun King, right? Sun King, the Jesuit King, which in the Marie Antoinette series, he presents again, but quote, on its own, functioning under Balsamo, end quote. McCarthy shows that from about 1774, it spread with amazing rapidity all over Europe, and that in France, it appeared everywhere side by side with the philosophers. And of course, the philosophers were all Jesuit educated. Jean-Jacques Rousseau, if you go through one of his, I don't know which book it was, man, I was reading it like a month ago. He literally dies by a Jesuit. Like, I'm not even joking. He literally like confesses like his fate for the like of like he knows he's gonna die, and he confesses his fate is because of the beliefs that a Jesuit priest has given him in like for advice to do certain things and go certain places, and he ends up dying because of it. And like you'll never see that type of stuff on any biography of him. But it was like, oh, I got to put it on my website. It was crazy. And of course, he was Jesuit educated. All the philosophers were. So, and they're following, yeah, the philosophers and they're following an association, which he notes as a very strange feature of revolution antecedents. And of course, the philosophia, that's what philosopher means, philosophia. But I forget what it stands for, but whatever. And then it says, these encyclopedias and philosophers we will notice presently. Meantime, it may be noted that if about 1770 Balsamo had been put in command of the French section of the vanguard, the successors of those quote-unquote initiated auxiliaries of Jesuitism in the century preceding, and if them, with the help of Weishaupt in 1773 to 1776, he had captured the Masonic lodges founded in 1725 by the Jesuits. So the Jesuits created something, then they blow their cover, and then they infiltrate it. And then they blow their cover, and then they infiltrate it. And then they blow their cover, and they do it over and over and over and over again. And had welded them into a single organ with the previously existing vanguard, the spread of the Illuminati in those years must seem by no means so amazing, though quite as portentous, as McCarthy thought. No more surprising than the sudden appearance in 1922 of the Italian fasci under Mussolini, whose true prototype was Cagliostro and his Illuminati.
Oh.
Later, McCarthy devotes three chapters, volume 1, 222 to 71, to the affairs in which Cagliostro played a notable part. One passage reads page 244. Quote, the Illuminati were to overturn the thrones of Europe. The first blow was to be struck in France. After the fall of the French monarchy, it was proposed to attack Rome. The society was said to have countless followers. It was said to possess enormous funds, the proceeds of the annual subscriptions of its members dispersed among the banks of Amsterdam, Rotterdam, Basel, Lyons, London, Venice, and Genoa. Specifically London, Venice, and Genoa. It was said that a considerable sum of money was placed at Cagliostro's disposal to enable him to propagate the doctrines of the sect in France. This was the origin of his first visit to Strasbourg in the autumn of 1780 when he adopted for his device the letters LPD, signifying Lilia Pedias Destru, trample the lilies underfoot, which is, of course, the lily is the symbol of the Priory of Sion, Priory de Sion, which was absorbed by the Jesuit order in 1617 to 19. It's supposed to be a phallus penetrating a vagina, the symbol of Lilith, the screech owl, Minerva, symbol of the Illuminati, right? To turn now to that other wing of the vanguard, which McCarthy notices as having been a kind of counterfoil to the Illuminati in the years preceding the French Revolution of, quote, the philosophers and the encyclopedias, end quote. He says, page 76, quote, D'Alembert was the only one of the great skeptics fostered by the sheltering wings of Jansenism, which was the only real competitor of the Jesuits that almost had the Jesuits destroyed for real, like, not as an actual, like, design of the Jesuits. Only the Jesuits can destroy the Jesuits. And where are the Jansenists? Gone. Absolutely exterminated off the face of the earth. Most of the other encyclopedias have been brought up under Jesuit influences, end quote. There you go. Then page 78, quote, the influence of the encyclopedia upon thought that tended to the revolution was incalculable. It was only not so great as that of Voltaire, end quote, whose connections with the Jesuits were reviewed in our first article. Of him, S.G. Taliaferro says, quote, Life of Mirabeau, page 1. Quote, Voltaire, more than any other man, undammed the torrent of revolution, end quote. And he shows how Mirabeau, quote, who had been at school with the Jesuits and had as his schoolfellow of Valjeanar argues, hereafter, the pure and pagan philosopher, end quote, afterwards did so much for the revolution. McCarthy mentions, page 200, that Turgot also, who became controller general at most critical epoch in France, was trained in the Jesuit college, Louis Le Grand, which is the College of Clermont. And I actually have Mirabu, Turgot, all these people are mentioned in my website of connecting to the Jesuits. One of the most important edicts issued by Turgot, McCarthy says, quote, when Turgot penned the edict 1774, he was unconsciously countersigning the death warrant of the old order and of the old monarchy of France, end quote. And this was on purpose. This was on purpose. Just like William Blackstone unconsciously helped the Jesuits. And who's the other one? You got to understand that the first time the Jesuit constitutions were ever published and made public was when the Supreme Court of France published them. Right, the same court council when they suppressed the Jesuits from France. Okay, so how is that even possible? Unless they were given them, right? They were literally not even known by the Roman Catholic Church and the Pope for like over, what was it? Like 250 years. And then they just get them right before they're suppressed. Who's the William Blackstone on? Yeah, Sir William Blackstone. He unknowingly suppressed the Jesuits. Who was the other judge who unknowingly suppressed the Jesuits? Forget what his name is. He was a judge as well. Here I have it. Here, one second. His name was oh my gosh. Oh yeah, Louise Ren de Car de Sout de la Chalatois, French jurist, Procureur General of King Louis XV of France to the Parliament de Bretagne, significant role in the Brittany affair, Knight of the Sovereign Military Order of Malta, author of the famous Jesuit created memoir Report on the Constitution of the Jesuits, which. Jesuit Hegelian dialectically was responsible for the order's orchestrated expulsion of the Society of Jesus from France. So, Knight of Malta helping suppress their buddies just so they can come back. Nimrod, resurrected from the dead. The dying and resurrecting Sun God is the Jesuit order of the mystery schools of Rome. Something Freemasonry will never tell you. Except for, what's his face? Jean Marie Ragon. All right, let's go. So it says, thus in the years preceding the revolution, we see two very powerful sets of forces operating for the overthrow of the old order. One openly opened in the light of day, which undeniably had derived its impetus from the Jesuits and which made its appeal to the intellectual classes. The other, which for the most part burrowed in the underground darkness, gathering into its train all the unthinking rowdy elements of unrest and disorder, which likewise be its origins traced to certain Jacobite leaders or to the Jesuit auxiliaries of the 17th century or to both, owed its being to the Jesuit Camarilla and formed a striking weapon meet for its use. This month, November 1931, in Toronto, Canada, hey, that's where I'm from, there has ended the trial of certain leaders of a rather microscopical revolutionary faction which for years past had been operated in just such a dual form with an letter A section working on very similar lines to those favored by the pre-revolution philosophers in France and a letter Z section, burrowing in underground darkness after the manner of Cagliostro and his gang. Sections B to Y of the movement, in the meantime, escaped particular attention, but doubtless, as it was in France from the middle of the 18th century, and as it has been in every land where this Upas tree has struck its roots into the soil. There are cohorts at work under nearly every letter of the revolutionary alphabet. The revolutionary alphabet is the Latin alphabet. The English language is a merchant tongue of Venice. That's why London controls the finances of the Holy Roman Empire, the sword arm of the temporal power of the papacy, protecting the spiritual power, United States of America. 14th Amendment, Empire of America, I should say. McCarthy has gathered together with assiduous care many of the facts concerning the revolutionary forces in France at the time, whose work will be seen in true perspective against its proper background. In this, quote, spacious days, end quote, of Louis XIV, the Jesuit Camarilla. And Louis XIV was the Knight of Malta. Three Jesuit confessors. One of them had him on his hands and knees for an affair. Pierre Lachaise, the infamous letter in the London Museum that you can go see. Well, you can't see it now, but... And of course, before, when I was talking about the Latin letters, talking about dog Latin and all that stuff, all capitals. Just like with the hyphens in between, right? Because it's real Latin. Just like COVID-19 has a hyphen in it because it's real. It's real. If it didn't, it wouldn't be applied to anything. In the spacious days of Louis XIV, the Jesuit Camarilla had ruled the roost through the keepers of the king's conscience and a succession of Jesuit father confessors, the last of whom, Letellier, not the Chancellor Letellier, who had signed executed the revocation of the Edict of Nantes, betook himself into voluntary exile on the king's death in 1715 when the Duke of Orleans became regent and a strong reaction against the Jesuits had set in. For the same time, indications had been multiplying that their heyday in France was over, for time at least, and that useless, they could regain power by other means, and in some other way, their day was over and gone. A few years later, when Louis XV, here we go, had held the reins of government for some time, two inveterate enemies of the Jesuits obtained full ascendancy over the king, Madame de Pompadour, his brilliant mistress, and here we go, Choiseul, his minister of state. This is the guy I was just talking about. They began to press for the total extermination of the Society of Jesus. At that point, to the eye that sees but part of the game, the day of Jesuit power in France must appear a thing of the past, but it was not so. Oh, you suppressed the Jesuits, oh yeah? No. The guy who suppressed the Jesuits was working for the Jesuits. How are you going to get rid of the Jesuits? You don't even know what they look like. They look like me. But it was not so. The very Pompadour working day and night for the destruction of Jesuitism received into her high favor, countenanced and supported to the utmost of her power that new wing of the Jesuit Camarilla's forces, the encyclopedias and philosophers. So the old fox, finding the front gate banged, bolted and barred against him, slimmed in again by a back way to find himself welcomed and caressed. Ha! The Whore of Babylon. The slimy harlot snaking its way in everything. You love her, right? I don't, but the world does. Well knew he the temper of king's mistresses. That's not one such could ever be a genuine supporter of that which he most feared, nor for long resist his charms, if not in this form, then in that. Though she might thoroughly hate him and in his character of Mr. Hyde, she must soon love him well when he should appear in the finery of Dr. Jekyll. McCarthy, however, is almost silent on this particular phase of the game if he realized how cleverly the Jesuit Camarilla had thus stolen a march of France, stolen a march on France. He has said as little as possible about it. Probably he was here in the light case with many he mentions in this history who were as unconscious of the bearings of their own actions as of the source of the impulses moving them so to act. Such hypnotized agents are oftener than not the most adaptable to the molding hands of their employers, free from all hypocrisy and guile. Any beam of better light awakening in them, some sense of hypocrisy, would set their feet on the lowermost rung of the ladder of salvation. But such rays of better light fall on such men but seldom. the character of quote-unquote civilization then introduced into France, if at first sight more approximate to Protestantism than to Romanism, it seems a curious fact that when the Roman Catholic clergy had been completely ousted in the early days of the Revolutionary National Convention, Protestants were welcomed, and some of their pastors even sat as members, till they found themselves between the devil and the deep sea. Is in reality Roman Catholic in its woof and its warp, and absolutely fatal to the religion of Jesus Christ. But on the other hand, this civilization cannot be described as altogether germane to the older type of Roman Catholicism. And remember, communism, because that's what the French Revolution was. It was the first taste of a Paraguayan liberation reduction system brought upon the destruction of a monarchy and the Roman Catholic system via the youth through the media. Okay? And it's communism is always the spiritual or mental stepping stone to fascism, which is what the Jesuits want. So when we say the Jesuits want communism, they don't. They don't want communism. They create communism to get to fascism, which is feudalism, ultramontanism, beyond the Alps, the Vatican. Theocracy. Just like the feudal days, right? Serfdom. That's where we're headed right now. This the thing that's going on right now is communism. But what's after this is theocratic fascist serfdom. But on the other hand, this quote unquote civilization cannot be described as altogether germane to the older type of Roman Catholicism. Tridentine Catholicism, in theory, at least stood in part on the same basis as Protestantism, differing only in the fact that it unwarrantably extended the word of God. If I understand this correctly, I agree with him. So I'm pretty sure he's just saying like the Protestants are hypocrites, pretty much. Beyond the confines of the Old and New Testaments, and included in it the sum and substance of the ecclesiastical traditions written and oral. The other brand, which first arrested general attention when the French Revolution arise, proclaimed their purpose to introduce and establish their much vaunted quote-unquote civilization throughout the world, is properly germane to Jesuitism only. A shiftly multifarious thing whose proper original is found in the cults of Babylon and Egypt, whose twin sister exists today in the Hinduism practiced. Not so much at the static shrines of India, but in full swing at her great periodical malaise, a true description of which would have made Miss Mayo's Mother India even more startling. Of course, Sanskrit was developed in Assyria, so it doesn't even come from the Indus Valley. And of course, Hinduism comes from Zoroastrianism. Zoroastrianism is from the seed of the Edomites, who were banded as a tribe after the fall of Babylon, where all man's religions come from. To men like Justin McCarthy, we owe much for exploring and mapping out many of the underground workings of this great conspiracy. It seems not a little curious that often such cryptic agencies have been brought to light mainly by those who were thoroughly conversant with the workings of the Roman Catholic mind. Naturally, who wholly unsuspicious Englishmen may have such things under their very noses without detecting the odors which immediately set good Romanists to investigate where the deadly gases are escaping. But for the patriotic action of a good Roman Catholic, the story of the gunpowder plot would have been written in ink of a very different color. To many other Roman Catholic, we owe the truth concerning some of the ramifications of the other vile plots of Jesuit Camarilla. I actually believe the gunpowder plot was a successful action, and it was supposed to... it was kind of like they... It was like, if you think about what they're going to blow up the parliament, it's such a theatrical history. Like, okay, so imagine the Jesuits blow up the parliament and kill the king. That's not going to do anything. They're just going to rebuild the parliament and put a new king in. That's the whole, like, mainstream media headline, front page, theatrics, like, theater. Why did King James the First give the Roman Catholic Church the union of the crowns? Explain to me that. Explain to me that. Well, you can't. You can't explain it to me. You can't explain it to me. Okay? He literally gave the Jesuits a crown. He reenacted the Magna Carta that was destroyed by the Protestant Reformation. This is the same King James who literally carbon copied the Geneva Bible, got rid of the footnotes, okay, and then said in the front, the Most High, King James. Who cares about the King James Bible, guys? It's not the King James Bible. It's the translators. King James is just another... most of England's rulers used Protestantism because they just didn't... It's the same... They're the same as Frederick the Great and Catherine the Great. They don't like the Catholic Church because they want to be the Catholic Church. They want to be the Catholic Church. It's the same thing, right? It's the same thing. And the Jesuits go, yeah, we can do that for you. Just protect us. And then the Jesuits backstab them. Same thing. That's why Protestantism isn't a nation. It's an individual. There's no such thing as Protestants. Only a Protestant. I'm not a Protestant. The Illuminati. To see things in true perspective, we must now glance back at the antecedents of those secret societies that played so important a part in preparing and shaping the French Revolution, which heralded the coming of the new quote-unquote civilization that now threatens the destruction of the British Empire, the devastation of the entire world, and the annihilation of the Christian religion. The antecedents of the Illuminati go back 200 years or more before their rise, and on their every appearance are seen in association as bodies under the direction of the Jesuit Camarilla. There were of two kinds, one semi-covert, semi-public, the other closely occult. The former consisted of those auxiliary agencies of the Society of Jesus, which, though like itself keeping their proceedings strictly veiled from outsiders, were like it also in declaring their existence, places of meetings, etc., so that in these respects they may be said to have functioned openly. The others burrowed underground. Their existence and modes of operation became known only accidentally. In the strictest sense, they were secret societies which discovered themselves only as burglars do by the results of their work. Exactly. So if I were a invisible superior in the Illuminati, I would be sent to the Illuminati to act as a novice and I would be spying on my own members. On the semi-secret associations too, and only be noticed here. One of these, the sodality named Prima Primaria, was formed in Rome by the Jesuits in 1563. And in 1584, it was approved by Pope Gregory the 13th. Nearly 15 years ago, and I'm pretty sure this is the same Pope Gregory the 13th under his Jesuit Superior General, Francis Borgia, who procured the Jesuits the right to deal in banking and commerce, which had not been granted to any other order but the Templars. And the Templars got it taken away from them. And the Templars were not behind the establishment of the Jesuits. I've proved this 1,000 fucking times. Stop saying the Templars are behind the Jesuits. Oh my gosh. Freaking annoying. It's so annoying. It's like the Jews, the whole Jew angle. And the freaking gray pope. You guys got to stop reading websites and start reading books. For real. You can know people's research on Rome and the Jesuits if they either read from websites or books in about like two sentences. So it says, nearly 50 years ago, an account of this leading auxiliary of the Society of Jesus was given by Father Gavin, from which it appears it was then 1885 at work in over 10,000 centers, and probably, and quote, probably three or four times that number of centers have been affiliated, though not registered, end quote. During the 46 years since that was written, the Roman Catholic Church in Great Britain has more than tripled the number of its agencies. The membership of this sodality must therefore be very great. It is strictly under the direction of Jesuit priests, to whom its members give regular accounts of all they learn and know. Well, is this well, may the Catholic dictionary say the reader very great, say they render very great service to the Catholic cause. Other semi-secret association is a sisterhood started by Mary Ward. It was organized on very similar lines to the Society of Jesus and by the Catholics of the 17th century. Its members were called Jesuit Tresses. In its early days, it had a very stormy career. Mary Ward was accused before the Inquisition and for some time was shut up in strict confinement in a convent. The sisterhood was abolished by Pope Urban the... The 8th in 1632. I actually have what he says. I sent it to someone recently. Yeah. Unknown papal bull. So you can't find this papal bull anywhere. It's censored. But it was May 21st, 1631, I believe. Quoted in Carl Theodore Greisinger's The Jesuits' Complete History of the Open and Secret Proceedings from the Foundation of the Order to the Present Time, page 304, it says, we have heard, not without the greatest mental consternation, that in Italy and beyond the mountains, certain women and maidens, after having assumed the name of female Jesuits, have for several years assembled themselves together without any approval or consent of the Pope, that under the pretext of leading a holy life, to possess certain houses of the description of and form of colleges, as well as profess houses over which a mistress under the title of female general is placed, that with the same object they have taken upon themselves the vows of obedience, chastity, and poverty. So the complete opposite of what those mean, and followed on all other usages and customs of the Jesuits, that they have, however, as well adopted many things very unsuitable for the female sex and directly contrary to the decorum and modesty appertaining to the same. So this is him saying androgynous without him saying it. Considering, therefore, that such creatures give occasion for much indignation, we have determined to eradicate those unwholesome weeds, as we are of a mind not to tolerate such wickedness. On this count, therefore, after consultation with our holy cardinals and inquisitors, we now command this alleged female society be entirely abolished, annulled, and done away with, and ordained that they, the Society of Female Jesuits, be ineffectual from the beginning and null and void, being herewith at once swept away, buried in oblivion, and completely eradicated from the Church of God. End quote. And of course, they didn't listen to anything that said. They went, oh, okay. Okay, man. Okay, yeah, sure. This is from Marie Joseph Eugene Sue, The Wandering Jew, which is like satire, A Tale of the Jesuits. So the Jesuits, they are the wandering Jew. I'm a Jew. I'm not a Jesuit, right? It's the Jews, man. So he says in his book, that book, Chapter 36, A Female Jesuit, page 290, London, 1845. He says, some words are necessary for the purpose of exhibiting distinctly some phases in the life of this dangerous and implacable woman who, by her affliction with the order of the Jesuits, had acquired an occult and formidable power. For there is something even more menacing than a Jesuit, and that is a Jesuitess. And when one has seen certain circles, it becomes evident that there exists, unhappily, many of those affiliated who more or less uniformly dress for the lay members of the order, call themselves Jesuits of the short robe, which is a Jesuit coadjutor. Marina Abramovic, she's a Jesuitess. She was hired for the Jesuits to do a art gallery mimicking Jesuit or Roman Catholic saints. I'll link it in the chat right now. In 2020, actually. All right, here's the original link by Jesuit priest Peter Von Dale, Ignis Magazine, All Miracles, Amsterdam, June 12, 2020. Dutch Jesuits hired Jesuit Tess Marina Abramovic for Marian Art Gallery and promote her in Amsterdam, Jesuit Ignis Magazine. Here you go. And then here's a translated version from Jesugel's translation. If you want to read it quickly. And then here, I'll send you the other shit I was reading. About the papal bull. And then Marie Joseph Eugene Sue's book. Classic. All right. Yeah, so in 1632, but it was later reformed online, somewhat modified. Today, it has many branches throughout the world, working in close cooperation with the Jesuits. So it never went. Never went. In fact, I believe this Pope literally just said this just so the other orders wouldn't be annoyed and jealous and mad. But like everything they say is a lie. So it's more for like the Roman Catholics that like go to church every day that maybe heard rumors of this and complained. Nobility maybe complaining, Roman Catholic nobility. But as far as like the actual hierarchy, like Pope has been a slave of the Superior General since 1542. All right. Well, we'll leave it here. We'll end it here. We'll continue on this paragraph. Bartley Gerba, sup, Carl, Luke, Michael. Yeah, isn't Martin Lee a professor at the Jesuit Hong Kong University? And he's a grandson of Jesuit priest Zhao Enlai, the real leader of China, of the Communist China Revolution. Fascism? Yes, fascism. Faggotism. Phallus worshippers. Yes. The first lie will be the last lie. It's the only lie. Is that really what he said? You shall not die. You shall be as gods. Mao's great leap forward killed at least 45 million people. Guess who he modeled it after? Read Romans. He modeled it after Jesuit priest Pierre Teilhard de Chardin's Omega Point. Was Jesuit priest Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, father of the New Age's theology, was the inspiration for Mao Zedong's ideology. Won't hear about that in mainstream media. What did it say? China is the best implementer of Catholic China is the best implementer of Catholic. Whatever. It's something like Catholic principles. Like an article from like 2017. I'm sure Eric's talked about it. All right, guys. We'll end it here. And, yeah. This book is good, eh? This is like the precursor. This is like the, what do you call it? The prelude? There's like the first movie, but then there's the thing that comes before. The prequel. This is like the prequel to F. Tupper Saucy's book. You know? For real. All right. We'll end it here, guys. So if you liked F. Tupper Saucy's book, you're going to love this book. All right, guys. We'll end it here. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. Please like the video if you haven't. Subscribe if you haven't. Turn on the bell notification. All that stuff. I don't know. Who cares? Like the video. Comment for the algorithm of the AI. And we'll see you all guys on Friday at 8 p.m. All right. Shalom.